Sigurd the Volsung, Chapter 3. This is on page 487 of your textbook. Sigurd's uncle reveals his fate to him. Regan recasts Sigmund's sword, Gram, for Sigurd. With it, Sigurd kills Fafnir and then Regan. After taking Andvari's treasure hoard, Sigurd sets out to rescue Brunhild, the sleeping Valkyrie. "Not long thereafter," Regan explained, "the night the king brought your mother to Denmark. I had bright hopes for my future, for I knew that the child she was carrying within her was a Volsung. I knew it was just a matter of time until I could avenge the death of my father and reclaim the treasure that is lawfully mine. I saw to it that your training would be in my hands. I have carefully reared you to reach this day. You have the courage, the strength, and the skill to kill Fafnir. All you need is the desire to help me. May I count on your help?" Sigurd replied, "My heart is filled with sorrow to hear of your father's and your brother's greed. Surely, Andvari's curse is the bane of your family. Nevertheless, if you wish me to slay the mighty dragon who is your brother, I will do so. Fashion a sword for me that is equal to such a task. If any smith possesses such skill, surely it is you." "That I will indeed do for you, Sigurd," said Regan. "You can put your complete trust in both my intent and my skill. For with that sword, Sigurd the Volsung will become known among all who walk the earth as Sigurd, Fafnir's Bane." Sigurd then decided to visit his mother's brother, who understood the lore of the dread Norns and could reveal the destinies of mortal folk. At first his uncle sat in silence. Then he said, "My nephew, it fills my heart with grief to speak of what those who rule men's fate have woven for you are very dear to me. The fabric upon the loom of your life is a rich tapestry indeed, with intricate designs woven throughout in silver and gold thread. Truly, your life shines with the brilliance of the noonday sun. The patterns reveal that you will earn everlasting fame by slaying the fearsome Fafnir. You will also kill Regan, the tutor whom you trust, and win the treasure hoard. However," Sigurd's uncle added, "Andvari's treasure carries with it the curse of death and destruction to those who possess any part of it. This curse will destroy your love for Brunhild, the Valkyrie. Brunhild's vengeance will set your dearest friends against you, and you will be treacherously slain. You will leave behind a loving widow who will avenge your death. Although you will die young, death is the common lot of all mortal folk," he concluded. "Always remember that it is the deeds you do while the wind of life blows within you that will bring you glory, honor, and lasting fame. You will be the most valiant of heroes, kind, courageous, fair, and skillful. A more noble man will never live beneath the sun." As he had promised, Regan fashioned a special sword for Sigurd. When Sigurd took the sword in his hand and struck the anvil with its blade, the blade broke into pieces. "You'll have to make a better sword than this, Regan," Sigurd exclaimed. So the smith constructed a second sword for Sigurd. Once again, when Sigurd took the sword in his hand and struck the anvil with its blade, the blade broke into pieces. "Can you fashion no better sword than this, Regan?" Sigurd asked. "Or does treachery lurk in your heart as it did in the heart of your father and Fafnir? Do you intend Fafnir to kill me after I have killed him?" Sigurd then approached his mother and said, "I have heard that my father asked you to save the pieces of his sword for me. If that is true, I wish to have them cast into a new sword. I intend to earn fame for myself by doing great deeds in the world." Sigurd's mother replied, "It is indeed true. As he lay dying, your father said to me, 'Carefully keep the pieces of my broken sword for our male child who is about to be born. They can be recast into a great sword called Gram. With it, our son will accomplish the deeds that will make his name live as long as there are bards on earth to tell the tale.'" Regan was angry that Sigurd would not let him pursue his own craft in his own way. However, the master smith obeyed Sigurd's instructions and recast Sigmund the Volsung's sword. As Regan withdrew the finished blade from the fiery forge, blue flames burned all along its edges. "Here," he said to Sigurd, "try this. If you are not satisfied, I can do nothing more for you, even with all my talent." Eagerly, Sigurd grasped the sword that had been his father's. Raising it aloft, he swiftly brought it down on the anvil, as he had the other two swords. This time, however, the blade remained in one piece. In fact, it sliced straight through the anvil, dividing it in two down to its base. "I think this sword will do," Sigurd said, "but I must put Gram to a more difficult test. Come with me." Sigurd went down to the river, where he took a piece of wool and tossed it upstream. As it floated by him, he struck the wool with his sword, slicing it apart as he had split the anvil. "You have indeed served me well, Regin," Sigurd exclaimed. "Gram will surely defend me against Fafnir." Sigurd and Regin set forth to find the mighty dragon. On the Nida Heath they found the path that Fafnir traveled each day when he left his cave to quench his thirst. The path ended abruptly at the edge of a cliff, and they found themselves staring down at water splashing 180 feet below them. "If your brother lies upon this path and drinks the water we see below us, then he has transformed himself into the largest dragon that has ever lived upon the earth," Sigurd exclaimed. "Fafnir's size should be of little matter to you, Sigurd," Regin replied. "All you need to do is dig a hole where this path is. Make it deep enough for you to sit in it. Then, when Fafnir comes down the path toward the water, take your sword and thrust it up into his chest until it pierces his heart. What an easy way to earn glory, honor, and lasting fame! Fafnir's fiery breath will not scorch you with its venom. His spiked tail will not lacerate you. His scaly body will not foil Gram's search for blood. Intent on quenching his thirst, Fafnir will have no thought of the peril that awaits him as he glides forth on his vulnerable belly." "That is all well and good," Sigurd replied, "but what if I should drown in the flood of Fafnir's blood?" "You are hopeless, Sigurd," Regin exclaimed. "No matter how well I advise you, your heart still overflows with fear. When your father died, he took the last of the Volsung courage with him. You will never be half the hero Sigmund was, for your heart is soft and weak. If you can find a better way to kill Fafnir, do it. I will be satisfied as long as you slay him." With these words, Regin cloaked his own terror and rode off, leaving Sigurd alone upon the heath. Sigurd set about digging the pit as Regin had advised. While he was working, he suddenly felt as if someone were studying him. He looked up to find standing above him an old, long-bearded man. He wore a blue cloak and a broad-brimmed hat that overshadowed his forehead, and he had only one eye. "Sigurd, son of Volsung, why are you digging such a pit?" the old man asked. "Whoever gave you that treacherous counsel intends to destroy you. You are digging your own grave, for the flood of dragon's blood will drown you in this hole. It would be far better to dig many pits leading off from this one. Then, while you sit here and let Gram pierce the dragon's heart, Fafnir's blood will drain off into the other pits." The old man abruptly vanished, and Sigurd realized that it was Odin, the Allfather, who had counseled him. When the tremendous dragon next slithered down the path toward the water, Sigurd was prepared with a network of pits and his trusted sword, Gram. Yet the young hero was unprepared for the terror that faced him. The weight of the monster caused the earth to rumble and shake as he moved along the path. The rhythmic explosions of his fiery venom caused the cliffs to echo with a progressively louder thunder as he approached Sigurd. But Sigurd courageously remained hidden in his pit. Soon the body of the monster covered the pit like a slab, extinguishing all light. Sigurd plunged Gram up to the hilt into the dragon's vulnerable, exposed chest. Although he quickly withdrew his sword, the blood from Fafnir's gaping wound enveloped him. Fortunately, the side passages drained off the excess blood so that Sigurd did not drown, as Regin had hoped. Fafnir bellowed like an enraged bull as excruciating pain engulfed him. Frantically, he lashed out with his head and his tail, hoping to destroy his invisible enemy. Finally, as he lay dying, his eyes spied Sigurd, who was watching him from a safe distance. "Who are you that you dared to match your sword against my might?" he asked Sigurd. "Surely my brother Regin must have challenged you to perform this deed, for I have terrified all who live in northern lands with my monstrous form and my poisonous breath, and folk for miles around live in dread of arousing my anger. I am comforted by the thought that he who led you to kill me also plans to kill you." "I am Sigurd, son of Sigmund the Volsung," Sigurd replied. "My courageous heart, my strength, and my sharp sword enabled me to bring your death upon you, and if Regan has cause to fear them, let him beware. Little good your heart and your sword will be to you, Sigurd, son of Sigmund the Volsung, if you take my treasure, Fafnir replied. The gold has been cursed by the dwarf and Vari. My beautiful gold ring and all the treasure in my cave are destined to be the bane of every being who possesses them. Death and destruction follow the gold as surely as night follows day, and no one who owns it will remain untouched by its curse. Only when the ring and the gold have returned to the deep waters will the bane end. So beware, lest my bane become yours as well. Sigurd replied, I would fear Andvari's curse and leave your treasure if, by leaving it, I could avoid my death. However, each of us is fated to die sooner or later, so to live in fear of death serves no purpose. It is far better to perform courageous deeds and win treasure, glory, honor, and fame. If, like you, each of us can keep our treasure until the day of our death, we are indeed fortunate. When it was apparent that Fafnir was dead, Regan approached Sigurd. Hail to you, Sigurd, son of Sigmund the Volsung, and Fafnir's bane, he cried. You have shown the greatest courage to face Fafnir and kill him. The fame this deed has brought you will endure as long as bards live upon the earth to sing of it. This deed will surely bring you no fame, Sigurd replied, for you left me alone to fight this mightiest of dragons. Do not forget that I am the one who forged your sharp-edged sword, Regan exclaimed. Without it, you would not have dared to attack Fafnir, because he surely would have destroyed you. You are wrong, Regan, Sigurd replied. What deed can a man perform, even with the greatest weapon, if he lacks the heart to do it? A brave man will win because he fights valiantly, even if his sword is dull-bladed. As Sigurd began to cut the dragon's heart out of his body, Regan said, I have one small request to ask of you, Sigurd. Roast Fafnir's heart upon the fire, and let me eat it. I would like that token of my brother. Sigurd obediently took the heart to the fire and roasted it upon a wooden spit. When he burned his finger on the bloody juices dripping from it, he put that finger into his mouth. To his amazement, as soon as the heart's blood entered his mouth, Sigurd could understand the language of the birds who sat watching him. There sits Sigurd, said one of the birds, almost completely covered in Fafnir's blood. He cannot see that a linden leaf has stuck to his back between his shoulder blades and is pressed there by the dragon's caked blood. Sigurd does not realize that the dragon's blood possesses such protective powers that from this time forth, wherever Fafnir's blood has touched him, no weapon of any kind will be able to harm him, added a second bird. If Sigurd could understand our words, he would protect his one vulnerable spot, said another bird. For he can be wounded only where the linden leaf has prevented Fafnir's hot blood from touching his skin. A fourth bird announced, Sigurd foolishly is roasting Fafnir's shining heart for Regan. Sigurd should eat that heart himself, for then he, not Regan, would become the wisest of all men. Regan is thinking about the best way to betray Sigurd, the second bird said. He longs to avenge Fafnir's death. He will try to trick Sigurd with crooked words. Sigurd is foolish to trust him. Sigurd should slice Regan's head from his neck. Then he would have all of Fafnir's treasure for himself, added the third bird. Before Regan beats Sigurd to the deed, the fourth bird exclaimed, as the saying goes, where wolf's ears are seen, wolf's teeth are close at hand. If Sigurd is wise, he will take care of himself. He will ride to Fafnir's den, collect Andvari's hoard, then ride to Hindfell, where Brunhild sleeps. That is the road to wisdom. Sigurd certainly has nothing to lose, exclaimed the first bird. He has killed one brother already. That is reason enough for the remaining brother to kill him. The birds are right, Sigurd thought to himself. Certainly, Regan will soon become my bane. If he shares Fafnir's destiny now, I will not have to fear him. Sigurd approached the unsuspecting Regan, quickly drew Gram from its sheath, and sliced off Regan's head. He drank both Regan's and Fafnir's blood. Then he ate most of Fafnir's heart and saved the rest. The birds chattered in a chorus. Place Andvari's ring on your finger, Sigurd. You have little to fear. Then ride to Hindfell, where the Valkyrie Brunhild sleeps, high in the shield hall that stands upon Hindfell, gleaming with gold within a ring of flames. The most beautiful of all maidens lies surrounded by gold, while red flame shadows dance upon her. Long has the shield maiden of Odin slept, put to sleep by the All-Father for disobedience in battle. She had pity in her heart and let the wrong warrior live, despite the dread Norn's decree. The sleep thorn protects her until you come to win her. Place Andvari's ring on your finger, Sigurd. You have little to fear. Once again, Sigurd obeyed the counsel of the birds. He mounted Granny and rode to Fafnir's den. There he found the treasure beyond dreaming. He found Andvari's ring in a special place and slid it on his finger. He placed Reidmar's helmet of terror on his head. Then he put the remaining treasure into two great chests and loaded them upon Granny's back. He planned to walk beside Granny to spare the horse his additional weight, but Granny refused to move, so Sigurd climbed onto his back. As soon as Granny felt the familiar weight of his master, he took off at a gallop as if he were carrying nothing but the wind. That is Sigurd the Volsung, Chapter 3.